I am live. Welcome to Table Talk, and next week we'll be back with the regular Table Talk, but this is a special Table Talk today because it's about the arts. It really is, and we have a show that's coming to the Fisher Theater, right?
Yes.
And it's called One Harlem Night.
Yes.
And I have the two actors here from that show, Eric Dion and Nikki Rochelle.
Yes.
Is your last name Rochelle?
That's actually my middle name, yes.
I thought so. Everybody, these stage names, you know. My stage name is Miss Perryman. Now, I swear, I have friends who don't call me Brenda. They call me Miss Perryman. I said, why is that my nickname? Now, One Harlem Night, we're going to get into that, we're going to take a break, and then I'm going to have one of my favorite people come on that everybody will recognize. So just stay with us because this is going to be a great show. But I want to first find out about you, Eric,
yes,
and you, Nikki. Yes. Where were you trained? Where did you go to high school? When did you start acting and so forth?
Well, I've been acting for a good 20-plus years.
Yeah.
And I fell into it because I was always the class clown.
I was voted class clown. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Oh, they didn't know what they were doing.
They didn't. But I was always the class clown. Everybody would always want me to perform at lunchtime. You know, do something to make me laugh. You know, so it turned into wanting to be on stage and with that and singing and, you know. I went to Davis Aerospace Technical High School on the east side.
East side?
Yes, east side. I didn't live there, but I took three buses to get there from
right.
the east side. But I just enjoy being on
so
stage.
So did you get some training?
Unfortunately, no, because the schools that I went to did not have performing arts.
Right, I know, but they're... So you learned on the job.
Yes, I did. I'm a quick study.
What was your first performance after high school and stuff?
Oh, my first performance, I would have to say, that's many moons ago. You're making me go back.
Oh, I could go back to when I was five.
Miss Pyramid.
Yes. I mean, you should be able to know.
Yes. If I can recall correctly, my first performance after high school was community theater, and it was Romeo and Juliet.
Very good. Yes. Very good.
I didn't get the starring role, but and I made a good extra.
Yeah, well, we got
to
start somewhere.
Hey,
there's a play called The Lottery. It's a one-act play, and it had the townspeople.
Okay.
I was a townsperson, and I threw a rock at the stone the woman. That's all I did, but yeah. I remembered that.
I bet you were good at it, too.
I threw the hell out of that rock. But anyway, Nikki, tell me about you.
Yes, okay, well, I actually went to Southfield Christian.
Yes.
And I've always been a professional dancer. I started in classical ballet, Latin.
Who'd you dance with?
O'Day School of Dance, Gerald and Leslie O'Day.
Okay.
And from there, you know, dancers are always taught to emote, of course, through music without words. So acting was pretty much the next step for me. My older sister, actually, Terrell Belcher, actually pushed me into acting. She kind of sabotaged me and brought me to a rehearsal that I thought I was just going to sit at and observe and actually threw me a script and said, okay, let's go.
So what was your first acting role?
First acting role outside of high school was Broadway Baby at Oakland University.
Great.
And right after that, it was Perilous Times.
Perilous Time, TJ
yes.
Hemphill. Right.
Yes.
He's getting ready to do that out of state.
Yeah, I did hear about that, yes.
Yeah, he's getting ready to do it out of state. Now, tell us about One Harlem Night.
Ooh, jazz musical thriller.
Well, let's first talk about the fact that Sherry Henderson, isn't she
yes.
the writer?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Phenomenal writer. This is my second production with her. And
can you speak a little louder? You got that sexy voice going on. This is my first one with her.
You have a sexy
okay.
voice, ED.
Okay.
This is my This is my second production with her.
Uh-huh. I'm back with one of my favorite people. You know her as Coco from what is the
105.9.
Okay.
Kiss FM 105.9.
Yes. Oh, projection is her life. I love it, love it, love it.
I learned it from you.
Ah, Coco's a Highland Parker, and she's an international artist, and you are in One Harlem Night.
No, I'm in the fashion show.
Oh, you're in the fashion show.
Yeah, we're doing
Lord.
Eric was trying to get me a role in One Harlem Nights, but I wouldn't act right. He wanted me to be a Della Reese-like character, shoot somebody in their pinky toe.
Well, I should. Oh, golly. Don't do that. I thought of that when Della Reese died a few months ago. That was the first thing I thought of.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't realize that. So I'll have the commentator and the creator up here shortly.
Yes. Yes.
So first and foremost, tell me what's been happening.
You know, still working on the road, still doing stand-up, still do radio. Love, 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 love doing stand-up. I am at a...
You all been doing it, though, a lot.
Yes, I have been. I have been busy. You know, you have to reinvent yourself and rebrand yourself. And with the age of social media that is so prevalent and in your face now, you got to get out there and make people say, oh, I remember her. You know, yeah, she a grassroots comedian. Yeah, but I'm still out here working, and I still could keep up with the younger cats that have been doing it not quite as long as I have. So you got to stay busy.
When you say keep up, you are still as funny as can be.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I paid attention to the people that taught me about just projection and owning the stage and owning the space on the stage.
You got to.
And all of those things. And those things aren't being taught. Well, no, I'm not going to say they're not being taught. They're not being adhered to. The rules of the stage are not being adhered to.
They're not. I see it all the time. All the time.
They're not adhering to the rules in terms of poise and articulation and stage presence. And even before you get to the stage, it's a process that you taught us and Miss Sanders taught us that we were taught in choir and stuff. The show begins when you get up the morning. Yes, when you get up the morning of the show. When you go to rehearsal, the show begins. When you decide to do the show, that's when the show actually begins.
Absolutely.
I've held on to that. I've held tight to that.
I mean, you don't start acting when you walk on stage.
No.
You start acting in the wings, in the mm-hmm. early morning.
Yes, you start in
the
morning.
And another thing, people get the best performances when they're thinking about what they're getting ready to do.
Absolutely. When you give it that energy, when you let go of the fact that, you know what, after I get paid, I'll be able to pay my energy bill and fill my gas tank up or whatever. But this time that I'm on stage, I'm owning this space. This is my space to own, possess, and take over. And it's mine, and I'm on it.
I haven't seen anyone who has your style.
Thank you.
You have just a great style, and you do command our attention. And the thing is, she's so subtle with her funny that it comes out to you, you weren't expecting it a lot of times. And then the ability to tell a story, that is a gift.
Yeah. You learn that. If you have spent any time sitting around, and I know you have, elders and just listening to, when they finally invite you in, because you know you got to earn the space to come into their presence.
Grown folk conversation.
So when you get into that space, you listen to them tell stories, and your aunt or your uncle could tell the same story 15 times a year, but each time they told it, it took you to that place. You went back to that place, that situation. If they talked about being in the Alabama sun, you start to feel warm, and the bumblebees and all of that stuff. Or when they got chased, you feel that. You take on all of that energy and adrenaline and all of that. So those things are important.
And another thing I notice about you and other comedians is your sense of observation, mm-hmm. observing people. You know, you have talked... I remember you told this joke about, you know, man, you know, he had many roles, you know.
Ooh, I wanted to be choicy about how I looked. I'm like, we look the same. We look like a pack of hamburger buns stacked on top of each other. And you making demands.
I know exactly what you're talking about. My goodness, how dare you? It's like, how dare you?
Tell me in that night, I'd be like, you want me to do what? You go to the gym with me.
Right.
You lowering your belt. Your belt almost, you almost sagging. You look like a hip hopper with your pants way down there because your stomach getting bigger. I'm sorry. I apologize.
You know, what got me, no, my brother said, well, when's the last time you saw your belt?
Shut up.
But, you know, just everyday influences can be funny, and that's what you use too.
Yeah.
Everyday things people see. Sometimes people don't even realize, oh yeah, that's right. You know, and then they see something like it, and then they start laughing.
It's that observation. It's the power of observation, because we see the same thing, but we perceive it differently.
Right.
So
right.
My role as a comedian is to bring you into my reality and make you understand that you saw the same thing or you experienced the same thing I did, but here it is again with a different twist on it, and now you could laugh.
And you didn't see it like that. Mm-hmm. Now, here's something kind of serious. Some comedians, like Jerry Seinfeld, and I'm going to tell you who they are,
okay.
Bill Maher, and a couple of others. So there are a couple of black comedians. I think, you know, to me, comedy is a no-holds-barred situation.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, people are talking about, oh, you're not being politically correct.
Absolutely,
right.
Yeah.
Do you find that there's a difference? I mean, white audiences, black audiences. I mean, do you think black audiences take more?
Black audiences are totally different with their attitude when they come to a show. And you get an audience of color that comes to a show, they don't want to sit up front, but they pay for the most expensive tickets, and then they don't want to sit up front. And the ones that did pay for the expensive tickets, like if they had a venue like the Fox or whatever, they want to get there late and walk down the middle of the aisle, and they want you to see them in a dress, this lime green fur coat that they got on. So sometimes the funniest part is me just standing there holding the mic, just watching them walk down the middle of the aisle, and everybody, 4,099 other people's eyes look at them, and I say, you see it. I ain't even got to say nothing. You see it. So it, the person expects you to say something, but when you don't, now it's funny.
Right.
But it's a difference, because they come with the attitude sometimes of, you better be funny. I paid this amount of money. You better be funny. And then non-black audiences come with, oh, I'm going to have a great time. We're going to get some nachos, and we're going to enjoy this show, whatever. So it's a different level of expectation, but now it's shifting to, we've become more knowledgeable, and we're reading more, and we're more educated, and, you know, we've had some travels and some experiences and some situations. So now you get both audiences that come in because of social media. So the white audience have been on one of the outlets and seen the same stuff that the black audience has seen on YouTube. So they like, I wonder what's going to be her take if she talks about the president, or how she going to talk about this particular situation or whatever. So they come now like, okay, yeah, how you going to do this? I want to see how you do it. And then when you're a woman, it's a double standard, because we can't say, we're not supposed to say some of the things that men say, but I do.
I
just say it differently.
Right. But, you know, one comedian, Kathy Griffin, I'm not a fan of hers. I haven't been a fan for, like,
a long time.
Like, a long time. She always got on my nerve. Let me break it down till it's broke. But here's my deal. Okay, she holds a head, bodiless thing of just a head.
Number
of 45. Trump.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Of 45. I got other names too that I can't say on television. But she holds that head, and then she doesn't expect to be put off of shows and so forth.
Yeah.
And then she's trying to, you know, get her way back now.
Yeah, and sometimes when things happen, or you feel like this is a time to say it, it's not the time to do it. You can think it, sometimes you could say it, but to actually do it, you know, and then after you've classified yourself as a D-list artist, you keep speaking that, and that's how people see you. And then you do something like this, and now you realize that, okay, it was a knee-jerk reaction. I shouldn't have done it. Now I want to win my way back into the graces of the audience that I had. And sometimes it's not that easy because we constantly rotating. You know, it's like, I don't like that no more. I don't want to do that no more. Because we, what's our attention span? Okay. 11 seconds?
Right, right. Short attention span theater. That's mm-hmm. exactly what it is now. But, okay, what about using the N-word all the time? I think that's kind of played out. I mean, I really do. No, I'm going to tell you. I think it's kind of played out because I go see comedians, and then it'll be one that uses it a lot, and everybody just is turned off. My daughter mm-hmm. called me from Freedom Hill.
Wow.
And she said, Ma, this comedian, and I happen to know a lot of comedians. Yeah. I knew this comedian. He keeps on saying this and this and this, mm-hmm. and he gets a little bit too nasty.
Yeah.
Now, used to be, you know, Richard Pryor would do a lot of things, and we would laugh.
Yes.
In fact, I have his one of his albums on my playlist, and I still laugh.
Oh, of course. It's
timeless.
It is. It is. It is. The N-word is sort of... I've used it on stage, but in terms of just saturating the audience with it, I don't like to, because I don't want other folks to feel like, oh, well, she said it 22 times on stage, so she comfortable with it, so I can say it. No, you really can't never say that to me. That's one of the things, no matter how many times we say it, how cool we are, or whatever, it's just some things that I will never call you, and there's some things that you can just never say to me. So I try to shy away from the N-word or the B-word. It's just certain words that I don't like to use, because you could tell people I'm tight because their shoulders go up because they're like, oh, my goodness. Mm. So,
yeah, you yeah. can tell, you know, because it just seems like some people, the culture or something has changed wherein yeah. people are feeling a little more uncomfortable mm-hmm. with it.
Mm-hmm. And the people that are feeling uncomfortable are us, and the people that's feeling comfortable are the other folks, and they feel like they could say it. I'm like, no, man.
Well, a lot of them, some of them, I've talked to them, they don't feel that comfortable with it. It's like, what do we do now, you know? I remember going to a P. Diddy concert. It was all these rappers. Anyway, this was out at the Palace, and it got me. Because I'm looking, because there's more white people there mm-hmm, than black. Mm-hmm. And they doing all the rap.
Yeah.
All
the words. And then when they get to that word, you kind of look at them like, you going to say that? You going to say that? And they kind of look at you like, I ain't going to say it.
Oh, but they did. They did. What was I going to do, little old lady at a rap concert? But anyway, I just wondered how you felt about that. Because I don't want rap. You're not a rapper. But you can rap.
Yeah, but comedians and rappers, we the same. They just sing about what we talk about.
Right, right. Life.
Mm-hmm.
Life as you see it. But I don't want them to censure.
Yeah.
Comedians.
Yeah.
I think it's wrong, you know.
Yeah.
And because there's this conservative base in this country.
Hmm.
And they're not all of the other people. Mm-hmm. They're black people, too.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know what to do because you're user-friendly. If they invite you to church to do comedy.
I'm doing church this Sunday.
Right.
Church? J. Moss is doing his one-year anniversary of his church, Living Waters, and it's inside of Cass Tech. So he and his wife are both pastors, and they're doing a one-year anniversary. So I'm performing at the church this Sunday. I perform for my church and other churches, and the pastors welcome me in. They say, hey, you know, always going to be a couple members that have an issue.
Are you at Third New Hope?
Yep, still at Third New Hope.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. I never forgot the name of that.
Yep, still there. My pastor loves me, and I love him.
Well, that's great. That's great. Well, I think, I was just wondering about that. It seems like comedy is getting big again, and I mean, not that it ever went away, but it's bigger now. Mm-hmm. And what about, because you all have been performing a lot. It's you mm-hmm. and who else together?
Mike Bonner and Daryl Earl, they
you
do.
You talked to Mike last week.
The Friday nights, I think it's the last Friday of every month at Mark Ridley's.
Comedy Cast.
Yes, and our audience is huge. all ages, and they come out to have a good time, and they get there real early, and they're sitting real close, and they're on the stage, and they're waiting to hear adult humor. They're waiting to hear, like, hey, you know what? I know the show gonna start on time. I know it's gonna end on time. I'll be home by midnight. I've seen a wonderful show, had a great time, and I can appreciate the diversity. And they bring other comics in. I can appreciate the diversity of the other comedians. And I appreciate the challenge of going on stage and competing with myself. My competition is never with another comedian. It's with myself to get the audience in. I want to win these people over and pull them into my world. And when I see them again, they'll be like, hey, you know what? I saw you so-and-so. You were so funny. That is what I'm trying to do, to gradually ascend to that Kevin Hart, you know, selling out a 23,000-seat venue or 40,000-seat venue and movies and all of that stuff.
I don't enjoy him.
Really?
No, I said I wish I could laugh. I don't. My son funnier than him. You know him. You know my son.
Oh, yeah, your son should dip his foot
I told him because he has people laughing all the time and can imitate anybody. But, no, I was going to ask you one or two more things before I go to you got to tell us about the fashion show,
yes,
too.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, you tell us, but I got to ask you one more thing.
Okay.
As far as comedy is concerned, how will people find out across onto the left coast or the west coast about Coco?
I'm always on social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and I'm reaching out to clubs, and you know, they just opened up two new comedy clubs, one in Augusta and I think one in Philadelphia. So you call and you know, they could always go. You could send them EPK electronic press kit, and they could check you out and say, oh, okay, well, you know, we got some dates open, or you know, we want to bring you in, you know, as a feature, or we want to bring you in as whatever, and you know, or we saw you, or I talked to some of my folks and they know you, because a lot of the promoters are getting younger and younger, and then they tell me, you know, I used to sneak and watch you on Comedy View. So, okay, so I'll bring you in. And I'm like, okay, well, I'm gonna come in. And you come in and you do your thing, and they're like, oh man. Sometimes they literally like pull the calendar out and say, okay, well, we booked up until next year, but can you come back in September of 2019? I'm like, absolutely. Because, you know, it's about keeping it in rotation. And,
absolutely.
And I'm always putting it out there. We still network. And, hey, I know this promoter in Nashville, Tennessee that got a spot and all of that.
Now, this one comedian, he's going to come over my house. He wants to do more physical comedy.
Okay.
I told him I'd take a look at him. He, you know, Richard Pryor did a lot of physical comedy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He feels that that will even make it'll make it even go further, the joke go further. But, you know, you got to be real careful with that.
Yeah.
So I told him he's going to do a comedy routine for me.
Okay.
And I'm going to tell him, because I'm hard to please with comedy.
I'm hard to please. Did he know that before he
I don't know.
Solicited you as a consultant?
Know. I don't know. But my thing is, too much of anything is abuse.
Absolutely.
And you could go overboard, and you just don't want them to go overboard. So tell us about Evolution Fashion Experience.
So it's an amazing, amazing woman. And I did an event, and I saw some of her work at the event, and I didn't know the depth of what she did and how involved she was. But I was like, I approached her and I was like, I want, you know, some of your stuff. So when I started doing a little research and had some conversations, I got some phone calls, and I told her my issue is being a person of size and a curvy woman or whatever, and tall is very challenging to find curvy stuff that fits you, and then the sleeves are long enough.
Right.
So if I need a white blouse, I got to go buy a white man's shirt. The sleeves are not long enough. And, you know, she was very like, oh, okay, that's not a problem. So she started.
And she's in the studio.
Yeah, she's in the studio.
We're going to bring her up in a moment.
So she started showing me some pictures, and then she actually did some stuff, and I tried some stuff on. And this woman is really laid back, very, very quiet, or whatever. But she is truly a genius when it comes to design and some of the things that she does. She teaches returning citizens, women, how to make these bags.
Oh, really?
that you carry stuff with,
yeah,
out of the hemp fabric. So all the fabric that's used
for the bags. I looked on the website. I saw that.
Yeah. She's very, very laid back. And, you know, I had a conversation with her, and all you got to do is give her an idea. And I'm like, okay, I like polka dots or whatever. She's like, okay, all right. You know, real, real laid back. And when I meet people like that, it's they process and they pull it in, and she processed it, and the inner genius kicked in. And when she showed me some of the fabrics for the evolution event, I was like, oh my goodness, that is going to be so beautiful. I am so glad that you allowed me to be a part of this event. So
wow.
The event is March the 25th.
I'm going to let her tell you a week from Sunday,
because it is the stuff. And then she'll be there on site to take measurements, and she'll have some of the items that she's done there for you to look at them in different fabrics, different textures, or whatever. Because, you know, I'm just really upset with curvy women. You don't really have to wear all black all the time. There are other colors that could pull you out. No, but you wear a lot of, you know, I wear colors. Yeah, but there are colors that could pull you out. Don't be afraid of makeup. Don't be afraid of colors. Don't be afraid to try stuff and modify to fit your specific body.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to bring them up.
Okay.
Thank you. What are you going to be doing, modeling?
I am one of the models. I am. You know, I do everything. I got my hand in
everything.
Every pot there, let me put my hand
you
in.
You learned well.
I could cook vegan. I could cook hood. I could cook vegan hood, tie, jump rope, whatever you need. I got you.
Okay. Coco, everybody, we'll be back in just a minute with this incredible designer and the MC. I think the
Yes.
I am back with the fabulous designer, Keka, right?
Yes.
And we have Lady J, who is the commentator, right?
Yes, I will be the host for the show.
Okay, speak up and speak in.
And speak up, yes. I will be the host for the fashion, evolution of fashion. I'm really excited about it.
And it's at Jam Handy.
It is.
I've never been there.
Well, it's I believe an old church, and it's been rehabbed and refaced, so it's amazing. It has bare bones, but it's a beautiful venue.
Wow, I'm gonna have to get over there. So, when did you start sewing?
I started sewing
and designing
about almost 25 years ago. So, I've been working in the city for several dressmakers, tailors. I started out with the gentleman. His name is DeLacy Dixon. I worked for him for 10 years, so I'm sure he's widely known in the city, and in Claudette Manners. So I started doing dressmaking with her as well, and her thing was curvy women. She was a plus-size woman, so she taught me a lot about how to embrace the curvy woman, her shape.
Oh, wow. I don't have any curves left, but... You know, I'm saying, I don't have any curves left. I'm out here. But I would love to come. I'm serious.
We all have curves.
I don't know. Really?
Yeah.
Oh, well. Lady J.
Hey, hey.
How many fashion shows have you done fashion shows before?
Well, yes, before getting into being a commentator and a host, I've done many fashion shows as I was a model. I still model, but, oh, God, countless. I can definitely say I've done 100 fashion shows and walked in a lot of shows.
Wow. So you know what it's all about.
I know what it's all about. So just being on the other side of it, not being backstage, it's pretty cool just to see being a different, you know, side of the fashion show, but working with Kepka.
That's a tough job being a commentator.
It is. It can be a very tough job.
I did that a couple of times. I said, get me out of here.
Because you got to kind of feel your crowd out.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah. Well, I was able to handle the crowd, but sometimes the models, my gosh. are you ready? Are you ready yet?
Ready,
how long do I have to kill time?
Yes.
Well, anyway, this is me. Listen, so tell me about the fashions of the curvy woman. What should you do? What to make it look like they're not wearing a tent?
Exactly. What I have found out over the years, and I just have to state, the evolution is including plus size. We also are doing regular size,
regular sizes
size as well, and
okay.
Men.
And men too?
And men as well. So I'm putting my tailoring skills to the test. However, over the last year or so, I've been involved in the curvy girl world. And I've
That's
seen.
That's a big world. I'm
it
not
is.
Talking about the girls. I'm talking
no.
about the fact that it is widespread.
It's a market.
Different brands are doing more plus sizes exactly. and so forth.
Exactly. And I mean, I mentioned to people and they kind of laugh, but, you know, everybody doesn't want to wear a tent or a muumuu, you know?
No.
And these women are super confident. Like, never take away the fact that they're confident, you know, regardless. They don't have to be skinny to be confident. They exude confidence. And I love these women. They are awesome, you know? And so to accentuate that is the thing, is the key, to make them not feel like they have to wear something that's, you know, oddly shaped, you know, and give them that confidence even more to just be like, this is my shape and I own that. So it's
well, there's
been fun.
So many different kinds of shapes too.
Yeah,
there are different kinds of shapes. There, the pear shape,
exactly,
where someone may be a regular size up here, but down there they may get a, you know, a little
yeah.
different, or top heavy,
yeah,
or just straight like me. No, I have no curves.
Everybody
I am
has
convinced.
Curves.
I just am convinced.
No.
Don't be convinced of that. We all have things that we want to accentuate and you know, and just
speak for yourself. I just want to blend in. But I mean, say it to the rest of the people.
We right. do. And I'm grateful and gracious to have encountered Coco. It was the Fuller Woman show, actually, that I walked. I came out. I was blinded by the lights. It was like a deer in headlights. So I heard her in the back. I heard her mentioning, because she was commentating. She was like, I like that. I had this long thing on I made just to go out because I was trying to cover up. But she said, I like that. I want one. So it rang in my ear, and we eventually connected. And what's coming to the evolution is Coco's line is called Coco's Off the Cuff. So you know what off the cuff means, that she rolls it, she keeps you going.
You never know what you're going to get. Oh, I'm excited about that. I'm so excited because, like I say, that's a market that a lot of designers wouldn't touch at one time.
Exactly, exactly. But the market is demanding it. You know, more women of color and
are embracing themselves.
They want right. to look flattering. They just don't want to put on something that blends.
Right. And they want to look different, mm-hmm. unique.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so,
I'm going to have to check you out.
Awesome.
Got to check
awesome.
Out Kriem. She's amazing. She, I've worked with her. Let's see. If you guys check out Kriem Keka's bio, she's done a lot of stuff. And
right,
I've got
right.
a chance to work with her too, and just the clothes are great. The way that people look at her clothes and the attitude they have toward her designs are just amazing. And now that you're
it.
Reaching into the curvy, like the curvy world, like you said, that's a big world, and seeing that people are so embracive of their curves and their body and having body positivity, and she's just coming right into that. People already have positive vibes to her brand. Now you can do it with curvy women. That's awesome.
Well, when say, for example, I'm going to an affair, mm-hmm. and I want a dress. Mm-hmm. I've gotten into dress. I love dresses mm-hmm. now more than I used to. Mm-hmm. I think I love dresses more now than I ever did.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What would I have to do? Come to you, mm-hmm. and you measure me.
Yes.
I'm telling you, straight up and down. what do you do with the straight up and down?
Well, what we'll do is I usually will get a feel for a person's persona, colors, and, you know, and definitely shape. And then we'll put something together. I will sketch out something. I'll give you samples of materials to look through. And we'll come up with something that says you. You know, it's my spin on it. But definitely something that accentuates you, that makes you feel comfortable, that says, hey, this is me, this is my style.
This is who I am.
Not something you pull off a rack that, you know, God bless designers, but, you know, without having a personality in front of you, you just kind of go at the market. But having a personality in front of you helps you kind of direct that design. And I have to also say, you know, shout out to definitely Lady J, because if it hadn't been for her, she put on a show called Kiss My Curves. So she also produced
Kiss
shows.
My Curves.
Kiss My Curves.
Kiss
That was cool.
And it had not been for her, I wouldn't have met her. She modeled for me prior to, but I would have never been inducted into the Curvy Girl world like I am now. And my manager, partner, and my sidekick, day in, day out, is Natalia Gamble. She is one of the models I met that actually walked. And, I mean, she had just got off the road. Mm-hmm. She walked barefoot, literally.
Wow.
And it's been ongoing ever since. So congrats and thank you to her, because it was the catalyst for everything we're doing now.
You are more than welcome.
I really would like to try to come to this, too.
It's going to be amazing.
So it's going to be on the 25th. I just want to remind everybody again.
Yes.
At the Jam Handy.
Yes.
From 6 p.m. to 8.
Yes, ma'am.
And that's at 2900 East Grand Boulevard, Detroit.
Yes.
It's going to be your showcase,
yes.
your premiere.
Yes.
And you seem to have just a different mind about yourself. I love the way you have wrapped that.
Yeah,
that is
thank
just
you.
God, a lot of us need to you need to do a thing on head wrapping. So we can, you know, when we're not together, we can wrap the head.
It comes in
hand. But you have a saying here, I will never stop evolving until I reach my ultimate majestic self.
Yes. I have a firm belief in we evolve every day, which means that we have to get up with a new mindset to do better, to enhance ourselves in some way, form, or fashion. I also appreciate what the butterfly goes through. So you see I'm wearing a butterfly, which is actually the butterfly that's on everything representing the evolution.
Right.
I have butterflies on my head wrap. I'm a butterfly fanatic. I actually have on our vendors. Jen's Finest Things, she created this bracelet set for me that has butterflies as well. But I feel like in this walk, I've been doing this for so long, and I train people on sewing. I've worked with several entities in Detroit training and just empowering other women, veterans, and so on and so forth. I want to die empty. So with that being said,
you want to leave it all on the field.
I want to leave it out here. So when I evolve to that majestic self, I'm going home. You know, that ultimate evolution. And so this is what brought out this fashion show for me, to showcase what I've been able to do over the years, that some people really don't have an idea of what I'm capable of. And I probably will never divulge it all in one, you know, on one plate. But
right.
This is an opportunity for me to do that.
You know, right. As you get older, you start figuring out even more things that you can do.
Yes.
Don't you find that?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
I understand now. $25 general admission, $50 VIP,
yes.
and which includes premier seating on the runway.
Yes.
That means we'll be like a Beyonce them
you
and
see it all.
sitting on the front row,
mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
One drink voucher and gift bag.
Yes.
The VIP hour starts at 5.
Yes, and that's a meet and greet. So you get to mix and mingle with some of the models myself. Mm-hmm. We also have other things that are happening at the show. So
tell us about them.
The VIP and the regular show, we're going to have a red carpet interview session with the Bunny Hole Media Group. We're also going to have so much media. We're going to have fashion bloggers, beauty bloggers. We have someone called Fatness Fiction that's going to be there.
That was my student. Positive. That was Elise.
Really?
Uh-huh. I was her drama teacher.
So we're going
I'm in touch with her all the time.
Art. We're going to have live art.
So I got to tell her that I had you on the show.
And a plethora of vendors. We have a young guy who's going to be there, Preeminence Inc. He's going to mix custom scents for you. So if you have a scent that you like, he can actually put those things. These are all exclusive things that you're going to be able to get that you couldn't just go out and get anywhere else. So we have premier vendors that are going to be in the house. We also have kidpreneurs that are going to be there. So two young ladies are bringing their brands to vendoring, and one is Nyla's Cupcakes. The other one is my daughter, Zuriana Novelties. So,
what are her novelties?
Well, she makes like this really funky, unique, kid-friendly jewelry, and like little. I taught her how to sew, so she makes little bags and things like
wow.
that.
Wow, so nice. This is going to be exciting, and it's a week from Sunday, everybody. Mm-hmm. A week from Sunday, right over at the Jam Handy.
The Jam Handy.
And if you're regular size, plus size, a man, or a man, you know, come. Everybody wants to be unique.
Yes. That's
Everyone right. wants to be different.
That's right.
I want a figure, but... I don't know.
Remember,
I think
everybody has curves.
That's what you think. Yeah. Yeah.
Just look at the clothes. She can fit anybody.
No, I believe this. I believe this. I have to believe everything Coco says, you know. And I believe you. I believe you. But Fatness Fiction, that's Elise. Mm-hmm. She was my drama student. I keep up with her in Indiana.
Wow.
I mean, I was at her undergrad graduation party. That's my girl. And when she started this, I was so excited. It's a student who, she started Fatness Fiction. She's working on her master's degree at University of Indiana. And she's a plus size young lady and looks so great in her clothes.
Yes, yes. Yes.
I got to come just to see her. I do. Well, congratulations, Keka. Congratulations.
You. Thank you.
Once again, if somebody wants to get some other information, do you have another way they could get information or number or
something? Absolutely. You can actually find us. We do have a website. It is www.creobykeka.com. That's CREOBYKECA. You can also find us on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook at the same
right.
handle.
Right, I saw Facebook. It's Creole by Keka.
Yes, yes. So any information will be conveyed there. You can actually go to our event page on Facebook. You can purchase tickets there. You can purchase tickets through Neptix. And you can also cash up us if you choose to. But you can get that information via email, which is creolebykeka@gmail.com. So we have several layers that you can reach out to us to attend the show. Definitely don't want to miss it because, you know, if you are a type of person who likes to have, like, your 15 seconds of fame, you'll get it there because we have plenty of media photographers, you know, just to shine and to showcase. And, again, we're excited to have Coco actually walking for us. She's going to walk her line. And introduce her line. So.
I can't wait to see that. I can't
be
wait.
Great. I know it is.
I can't
awesome.
Wait to see that. She's going to have this line. I got to find out who's sewing it for her.
It's a movement.
It's a movement. Listen, this is great. Everybody, next week, Table Talk will be back on with the panelists and so forth. Had to take a couple breaks because I have so many people trying to be on the show that I'm trying to get everybody in. This was special because Coco told me to do it.
Aww.
I mean, well, they used the magic word was Coco. So I will see you next week, and good luck on this, on the Evolution Fashion Experience, March 25th.
Thank you. Thank